All righty. Hey, God bless you, church. Great to see you here tonight. And we're going to have an awesome time as we just push into the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I don't know what happened after conference, but everybody seemed to got sick. Sunday was interesting because two of our senior members fell over on the stairs trying to get into church and grazed up hands and heads and bits and pieces. And then there was actually people getting ill during that they're feeling not well, getting ill during the service and heading home and going to bed, and got lots and lots of people just illness seemed to hit the place. But I actually felt on Sunday really interesting because I felt like a real spirit of witchcraft operating, coming against the church. So we'll have to deal with that tonight. And I don't think the enemy was too happy. I mean, conference was such a powerful, incredible time. And John's got on YouTube, he's got a list of, it's actually 66 messages on the apostolic ministry, but they're only like 10 minutes each, 10 to 12 minutes. Really, really, really good teaching, really interesting stuff. Not everybody's kind of interested in the apostolic, but it is really, really interesting as he's talking about what he believes is going to come to pass in the church and that. And I've been really enjoying going through all of those studies and taking my notes and doing bits and pieces. So exciting stuff. So we're gonna push into the presence of the Lord. And I just love that. I love worship. I love the church. You know, you're the church. You know, I say I love the church. I'm not in love with the building, say. But you guys are pretty awesome. Love the church, love the Lord, love the moving of the Holy Spirit. I love the word. The more I read the word now, because Christ is the word. You know, in the beginning was the word was with God, and we know that the word's the living word. And every time I open the Bible these days, I just think of Jesus. You know, I feel like the Lord's talking to me through the word. You know, that it's the Lord, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Especially, I mean, it comes all the way through the Old, but especially in the New Testament, it's absolutely the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's just an amazing, incredible revelation. And we've been transformed into that image, into his image. And that's pretty exciting stuff. So let's just stand and prepare our hearts just to enter into his presence tonight. So Heavenly Father, we just embrace you. We love you so much. And Father, we honor you. We're forever grateful for everything that you've done in and around our lives, our family, the church. We just love you, Father. We're not afraid, Lord. We're not wanting to be independent or separated or isolated from you in any way. We just want to be in submission. We want to just rush into your presence. We want to hear your voice. We want to know your will. And we just ask that you'd help us to obey and to respond to you. And Holy Spirit, we know you're God on earth right now. We know that you're in us, around us, you're on us. And Holy Spirit, we ask that you'd lead us. Anoint us to worship, anoint us when we read the word, anoint us, Lord, with your great love, anoint us to understand, Lord, what you have for the body. And Jesus, we just lift you up. We always just want to lift you up. And Lord Jesus, we just thank you for all the sacrifice and everything that you've done. And tonight we take authority over every spirit of witchcraft. We take authority over every principality, every power. We come against the spirit of sickness and the spirit of infirmity, and we command you off the body in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We bind your works. We bind your operation. We bring you out in the light. We expose your works. I take authority over every spirit of deception, every spirit of doctrinal deception that would try to attack the church, attack the people. And Lord, we'd ask that the spirit of truth would bring and teach us all your truth. Truth, Lord. And we're forever grateful for this in your mighty name. Amen? Amen. All right.
you've done before in greater measure. You will do again. There's no reason walking in breakthrough. No mountain can move. All things are possible. There's no broken body.
Oh, the throne room before you.
We thank you, Lord. We give you praise and we give you honor and we give you glory tonight. Father, we just ask that you'd open the eyes of our understanding. We ask, Lord, that you would speak into our hearts from your word tonight. We ask, Lord, that you would break the bread of heaven and feed us tonight in your mighty name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Bless you guys. Thank you, team. Awesome. We're getting there. I've got a few things for you tonight. I've been having a really good week in the presence of the Lord and just enjoying Him. I felt there was a couple of things on Sunday that sometimes when you're preaching, you don't necessarily feel like you get it across and that you nail it down. And so I want to have a look at a couple of the scriptures that we were looking at from Corinthians. I'm going to read from Corinthians and Galatians and Corinthians again. And then we're going to have a quick look at Ephesians, because I just want us to see the difference between the gifts of people and the gifts of the Holy Spirit and how God distributes it. Because sometimes when you're reading, say, in the Corinthians 12, chapter 12 list of the gifts, it's easy to read and to miss exactly what the Lord is actually saying in there. But it's what you could understand too, that all of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, this was all given to the church after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ, you know, he lived, he died, of course, he was resurrected, and then he sent the Holy Spirit, and with the Holy Spirit comes all of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, all of the fruit of the Holy Spirit, all of the power of the Holy Spirit, all of the, as John would put it, the graces of the Holy Spirit, or that would be like the anointings of the Holy Spirit. They all come, you know, after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the life of the church. it's really interesting because the person of the Holy Spirit, it says in Corinthians 6:19, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You're not your own, you were bought at a price, therefore honour God with your bodies. So the presence of the Holy Spirit actually indwells us. We're the temple of the Holy Spirit. And he's in us. Years ago, I won't tell you the story again, but I had that story with the mirror, you know, and I looked in and saw the eyes of the Lord looking out, and the Lord spoke to me and said, where do you think I dwell? And the Lord gave me a revelation. I thought, well, you're inside of me, because I was looking in the mirror, but when I looked at the eyes, they were not my eyes. They were like the eyes of the Lord. And it's hard to explain some of the encounters or experiences you have with God, but it felt like the eyes of God, the love coming out, you just almost like you were drawn in to the love of God, the beautiful, powerful love of God. And so it really brought home a really clear revelation for me personally that we are full of the Holy Spirit. You know, we might go through our day-to-day lives and not be conscious of that, not be aware of that, but that's the reality. The reality is that everywhere we go, everything we see, everything we do, we're doing it all with the Holy Spirit indwelling our lives. And I think if we're living in the realization of that, we will realize that the power of the Holy Spirit is manifesting wherever we are. and it changes our awareness, often changes the dynamic of what goes on in and around our lives, just because we're aware of the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. So then things that might happen in our day, we might perceive them more clearly as spiritual things rather than just natural circumstances. I'll turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. This is, you'll all know, you would have read these scriptures, and that's the, telling me I've got login problems. I don't have login problems, mate, come on. And you see where I'm going to start reading here. I'll start from 12:1, and it doesn't matter if we read a little bit of extra scripture. What I want to talk about now is the various way God's Spirit gets worked into our lives. I'm on the message. I've got to get out of there. There's only ever one verse I've found in the message that I really liked, but much to Nancy's distress, so... Oh, here we are. We're back to the real Bible, the New King James. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Differences of ministries, but the same Lord. There are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. And what we're going to understand here is this is very much the gifts of the Holy Spirit that are distributed to the whole body of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you are born again and filled with the Spirit of God, these gifts are distributed to you. And as you go on, when you begin to exercise the gifts of the Holy Spirit, I believe what the Holy Spirit does, he will clarify what gifts he has given. There's a lot of belief, and I don't doubt this also, that God can move through us at any time with any gift. So if it's the gift of healing that's required and we're the only one there, I don't doubt for a moment God can do whatever he wants to do. But what you will find is often that there are certain gifts in your life that just operate over and over again. They're just like resident gifts. I've always felt like, even though I don't minister so much in it now, but right from the start, one of the gifts the Lord gave me was discerning of spirits, and which worked out in the ministry of deliverance. And that was just something right back in my baby Christian life that began to manifest in my life. And when you look at your own life, you'll find that there are certain gifts that God has actually given that you'll identify with. In Galatians 5:22, it talks now about the fruit of the Holy Spirit that came with the Holy Spirit. So when you get the Holy Spirit, you get his fruit. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And against such things there is no law. So isn't that interesting? Because all the way through, and especially in the writings of Paul, he's always bringing this distinction between the grace of God and the law. And there's a lot of warnings in Galatians about, you know, who has deceived you after starting off in the Spirit. You're now going back into the things of the law. But he's saying that the fruit of the Spirit, against these things, there's no law. They will not come under the law. And so the fruit of the Spirit is it's a higher authority or a higher function, actually, than the laws, I believe. And then when you go into 1 Corinthians 12, we're back in there again, but we move down a little bit further to verse 28. It's really interesting there. And then because it changes, because before that in the same chapter, it's been talking about all of the gifts that God gives to the body of Christ. And then it switches here. And he says in verse 28, and God has appointed these in the church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers. After that, miracles and gifts of healing, help, administration, various types of tongue. What's actually happening here is the gifts of people, what we'd call the fivefold gifted ministry, is coming in and out in Corinthians chapter 12 with the spiritual gifts that are just given to the body. So the gifts of people are people actually anointed by God for the body of Christ to bring the body of Christ up to maturity and to the full stature of the Lord Jesus Christ. But Paul doesn't distinguish clearly between these, so he goes back in between. And the reason you can say this is verse 29, he goes on, he said, then are all apostles? And with a question mark, and the answer to that, well, is no. Are all prophets? No. Are all teachers? No. Are all workers of miracle? And it goes on and talks like that. So what we see the two distinctions being between the spiritual gifts that God gives to the whole body and then the gifts of people that God puts in the body for a divine purpose. What we see over in the book of Ephesians, we come across there, so we go Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7, and it says this, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, he will ascend on high. He led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. And that's relating back, really, to that list of gifts in 12 about the gifts that are given by the Holy Spirit to everybody who's filled with the Holy Spirit. They have access to the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But when he gets over into Ephesians 4:11, it shifts over to the gifts of people. For there he says, and he himself, Jesus himself, gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. And that's now switching back to the people gifts that are specifically given that we recognize as fivefold gifting. The thing about what we've got to understand is the body of Christ who are gifted by God, those gifts are meant to function, I believe, they will function inside the body, but they're primarily designed to function outside of the body. So you can be in a supermarket and get a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom, or there can be a gift of healings on you anywhere, everywhere you go. But the fivefold ministry gifting is a gifting for within the body. It's a gifting that functions within the church to bring the church up to a place of maturity. I was quite challenged by a couple of things that John said when I was looking at some of his tapes, and one of the things that he said was in John chapter 17, talking about the prayer of Jesus, and the prayer of Jesus is, Lord, make us one as we are one. You know, I'm in you, you're in me, them and me and them, and it's talking about coming to oneness in the love of God and the revelation of the one of God. And it's actually talking about the body becoming one together, no longer tribal, no longer separated, no longer divisive, but coming together in oneness. And then what he said that really struck to me, he said, do you think the prayers of Jesus gets answered? Well, yes, you know, it's like if anybody's going to get their prayer answered, it's going to be Jesus, isn't it? And then he said, well, do you think the prayer of Jesus has been answered? And then the question might be, or the answer at that point might be, well, potentially, but actually, there's still an awful lot of division. There's still an awful lot of division in the body of Christ, around the body of Christ, even within individual bodies of Christ, there can still be an awful lot of division. So that prayer may not necessarily have been completely fulfilled yet, but
if Jesus Christ prayed it, it's for it to be fulfilled. That's the reality of it. Depending on the reason that your understanding of the scripture is so important, because the way we look at and see and perceive and the scripture is revealed to us will really very much determine the way we live our lives, the way we live on a daily basis, and our expectations of what God is actually going to do in our lives. I love those verses in Ephesians, and I'll just flip over there. But I love the I don't know what it keeps on saying. There's a problem going on here with my thing, and there is no problem. Get away from me. I don't know who's behind. There's somebody living on my computer that's doing weird and wonderful things. So these are really, really very beautiful, I believe, and powerful words if you understand it. And he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come, that word till, I think in the King James it says until, or till is the means the same thing, until we all come to the unity of the faith. Well, I don't, have a look at the churches in the city, are we at the unity of the faith yet? I don't think so. Until we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. And that's really interesting, because the fivefold ministry is a protective ministry for the body of Christ. It's to bring you up into the wisdom of the word, the understanding of the word, and part of it is so that you're no longer children, that you come to maturity where you're not tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. You're consolidated and solid in the things of the Lord. But then it goes on, it says, but speaking the truth in love, we may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share and causes the growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. So what we see is these gifts of men, these fivefold ministry gifts that are the gifts of people that are given to the body of Christ, are to bring the body up into a place of maturity in the fullness of the stature of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we Then the gifts begin to work, function, the body begins to work how it's intended to function. And that last little bit of that scripture, which is really neat, and causes growth of the body for the edifying itself in love. So when the gifts are flowing properly, the body is edified in love. So the love of God becomes really evident within the body. And it's quite interesting, really, because if you were to boil down a lot of theology, like functional, practical theology for the church, is love God, love people. It doesn't get much simpler than that. It's love the Lord your God with all your heart. Love God, love people. Love God, love people. If you love God, you will love people. Yeah, you can't avoid it. That's the thing. It's an unavoidable revelation or expression of God. If you love God, you will love people. I wrote down a couple of scriptures quickly just before I came out, and I'll see if I can find one of them here. This is 1 John, the letters of John 1, 2, and 3. It's interesting because they deal a lot with this area of relationship and the love within the church. It says here in 1 John 2:9, if anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or a sister is still in the darkness. I mean, the thing about the scripture is we do have a way of smudging it and lessening its impact. But if you read it and take it literally, like if you just take that, anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is in the darkness. Anyone who loves his brother and sister lives in the light, and there is nothing in them to make them stumble. So that's a big statement. There's nothing in them to make them stumble. So what it's actually saying there is if you allow offense or differences or division or hatred or wrong attitudes to come between your brothers and sisters, you've set yourself up for stumbling. That's what it's actually saying. It's saying that the one of the biggest obstacles, or one of the obstacles that cause people to stumble the most, is the relationship they have with people. And when those relationships with people get broken, then, you know, there's consequences of that. But it says, but anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. Isn't that interesting? The blind. They do not know where they're going because the darkness has blinded them. And this is because, you know, that God has no grandchildren. You know, everybody in God's economy, we're all the children of God. So we're all brothers and sisters. There's no cousins or grandkids or great-grandparents or anything like that in the kingdom of God. We're all brothers and sisters, and we're all the children of God. And so really the emphasis here that God is putting on is the quality of our relationships one with another is actually a revelation, or it's the way we reflect our maturity or our intimacy with Jesus Christ. It's. I was thinking about this a little bit the other day, and I thought, you know, Satan's whole mode of operation revolves around breaking relationships. That's what he did in the garden when he said to Adam and Eve, you know, it's quite nasty the way he deceived. He said, you know, if you eat the fruit of that, you will become like God, sort of making out that in some way God was withholding something from Adam and Eve. You know, like, you've got all of this. I know God's done all this, but if you were to eat the fruit of that tree, you will become like God. God's been holding out on you. Possibly he might have said you'll become gods, because that's a sort of a deception that's going around the body. But now they think that they're little gods. They think that because we're born again with the Spirit of God, we're no longer the creation, but we've become the creator, you know, that we've become little gods. But so what you're going to understand, so he managed to break the primary relationship between Adam, Eve, and God himself. Adam, when God created Adam, the intention of Adam outside of sin, if he never sinned, was that Adam would have been a blessing to all of humanity that came after that time. But because he sinned, he became a curse. The curse came on all of humanity. And then it's an interesting thing, because when you see Abraham comes along, the promise that God makes to Abraham is that he will be a blessing to Father Abraham, father of the faith. In the New Testament, it talks about he is our father, one of our fathers in the faith. And what God was actually reinstituting there in the time of Abraham is this Father Abraham who was going to bless all of the nations of the world. We all get by faith the blessing of Abraham over our lives if we come in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's a re-establishment. So let's jump back into the dirty devil. And so what he actually does is he works to break relationships. His kingdom is based on broken relationships. And you're all human. You've been around. You know the ropes. You know, marriages, divisions between brothers and sisters, best friends, it just goes on and on and on and on. And the works of Satan is always destroying relationships. That's why, I think Christian marriages are often under real threat, because if the enemy can destroy a Christian marriage, if he can bring division and separation and bitterness and resentment in there, see, he's winning the battles. He's winning the relationship. The marriage relationship, which was instituted by God in the garden before the fall, it was a covenantal relationship where God brought a man and woman together as one in him. It was a pulling together that we talk about, the threefold cord in marriage. It's the most intimate of relationships, like the two halves of humanity being put back together with the presence of God right in the very midst of them. So if Satan can get in between a marriage and separate that, he probably feels like that's a great victory. So if we're born again believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, marriages will come under threat. They will get challenged. The enemy will try to challenge. It's really interesting too, in the book of Luke, it talks about, to the degree that we forgive others, God forgives us. And so, again, this is talking about our relationship with each other to the degree that we forgive one another for the misunderstandings and the pain and the hurt and the things that actually happen in day-to-day life. To that degree is to the degree that God actually forgives us. So we can hold ourselves in the under the judgment of God because we're holding our brothers and sisters or friends under the judgment of God. We judge them with maybe we've been hurt or bitter. We judge them. We hold them in our judgment. And at the same time, God is then holding us in his judgment. And in 1 John, it says, then we're blind. You know, we're walking around in the dark. And so we've got to understand that this whole thing of relationships becomes absolutely really, really critical. So if the kingdom of darkness is based on broken relationships, then the kingdom of light must be based on strong, loving relationships. And that's what we see all the way through the Bible, that love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, your neighbour as yourself. That's what we're seeing all the way through. That's why at the end of Corinthians chapter 12, when it talks about all the gifts, and then it goes on and it talks about, and the greatest of these is it talks about love. Because what it's actually saying there, it's not saying that the gifts are unimportant. It actually says that we should seek spiritual gifts, especially prophecy. But it talks about love because love overrides, like the gifts need to operate in love. The church needs to operate in love. Marriage needs to operate in love. and so that's like the hallmark, you know, that's like the foundation is the love of God. And I love the fact because I realised in my life that, especially before Christ, I don't think really I had the capacity or the capability to love. I remember young Christian in Bible college, Nancy and I were having, we were only like 18 months old in the Lord, and we were having lots of battles and struggles at Bible college, great big massive arguments and fights going on. We entertained the whole Bible college, you know. Most of the kids in there are all like pastors' kids. They're growing up in these lovely homes and everything like that. And then the ex-druggy gangsters come to town and we're just rough and raw, you know, and we're going for it and we were having some battles and I remember going one time, I went to the Bible College president because they were all doctors of psychology and Christian counselling, spiritual counselling, and that was kind of their training there. So I went and had this thing, and I remember he said, you've got to love your wife and you've got to love Nancy. And I said, well, I do, mate. You know what I mean? I married her, didn't I? You know, but I actually realised after he talked to me for a little bit, I just didn't have any understanding. I didn't have any understanding of expressing love. It really, at that time, you know, I just felt. I remember after the session, I felt good and bad. You ever sort of had counselling and felt good and bad? I felt good because I'd learnt something new, and bad because I was an idiot. You know. And just going away and thinking about that, how do I express that? But you know, I think and you know I worked at it, and you know you try to do your best. I took out the rubbish and all those other very important things. Said thank you for dinner. You're awesome. Started reading the Book of Solomon and talk about cabbages, tomatoes, kumara and pools of water. But anyway, I don't understand that book to this day. But anyway, when I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, God did something in me. And then I realized, because I know I say it quite a lot, but the love of God is shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Spirit. And it's not a natural love. It's not a human love. It's the love of God. So, see, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I feel saddened for Christians that only get saved and never go on into a full revelation and understanding of the Holy Spirit because they miss out on so much. They just miss out on so much. But as far as like being the ability to love the body of Christ, it comes from the Holy Ghost, not something you work up where you're running around trying to be nice to everybody. It's actually a spiritual anointing that comes from the Holy Spirit, where His love is shed abroad in your heart, and then His love just begins to get expressed out of your life. And things, when the love of God is shed abroad in your heart, things happen to you. The way you look at people, the way you see people, the lost, your heart for the lost, all of those things, everything begins to change. And I just think that is so powerful. So I suppose you could say that love is the glue that holds everything together. You know, love is the glue. And it's even the glue that holds us with God. We're held in God's presence by His love, by His great love, you see. And then it holds us together. I remember years ago getting a definition: the opposite to love is not hate, it's I don't care. The opposite to love is I no longer have time for you. I don't care about you, I don't want you in my life. Because what you find in the body of Christ and the church, I believe that the church is meant to express the covenant love of God to the world. They will know you're Christians by your love. They'll know you're Christians by your love. So when the church is bickering and fighting and arguing and people are leaving, oh, you know, I'm out of here, I can't go give you a toss, it's really undermining our witness into the world. Then the people out there that think, oh, you're just like everybody else. It's like the Bloomin' League Club down the road. You're just the same as them. What's the difference? So we've got to understand that. We've got to understand that in the body of Christ, you come to this thing. It's like a marriage. You come to this where your relationship becomes covenantal. And the responsibility is on resolving the issues, not running away from the issues or throwing your toys out of the cot. And really what you when people are dividing and isolating and that, what's actually going on is the enemy is attacking them. Right, the enemy is breaking down the relationship that they should have with the body. And the thing about it is, like, you know, there might be someone that's struggling in their relationship with me, which is probably half the church, but there's reasons for that. It's not because I'm a lovely guy, but I am a lovely guy. But the thing about it, if somebody's struggling, and the reason I tell you why a lot of people will struggle with the relationship with me, because my relationship in the body is also a relationship of authority. So whenever you get independence, rebellion, all of those things, the people, they don't want to be around authority. They that's the thing, because authority becomes a big issue to them. What does it say in Romans? You know, if you're keeping the law, you don't have to be afraid of the authorities because they're actually there to bless you. But when you begin to get out of sorts, then you don't want to be around the authorities. But what you've got to understand in the body, and this is often where the body falls down in its function, is when people that are struggling with somebody else in the body comes to you, your responsibility is to really challenge them to reconcile that relationship. Don't talk to me about it. Go to them and sort it out, because that's what the scripture tells us to do. Don't go around all around the church moaning about everything. Go and sort it out. And see, I believe too that people who won't sort it out is because the broken relationship gets in their life brings the blindness. And instead of sorting it out, when the deception comes in around their minds and around their lives, they want to avoid the authority. And then when they start avoiding the reconciliation of relationship, they'll create all of the reasons. The reasons are rubbish, but they'll create, oh, I'm not going to talk to them because of this and this and this. And, oh, they said that, or I heard this, I heard that. Like, so-and-so said to so-and-so, who said to so-and-so, who said to so-and-so, who said to so-and-so, who said to me he didn't like me anyway in the first place. And what he'd actually said to the first guy is, I really love that person. And then all the Chinese wisdom has taken over, and by the end it gets round to this person who's already got a relational struggle. Said, yeah, I knew they hated me. You know. Anyway. So So when God has given you responsibility in the church, when you have authority from God, not self-appointed, when you have authority, ministry areas, because a lot of you people are ministering in various areas of ministry. It might be in the music ministry, it might be in the ministry of dance, might be in kids' church, might be 412, it might be wherever. Wherever you're ministering, you actually, if you're there appointed by God on the church, you actually are, it's an authoritative ministry. So you wonder why the dynamic with your friends changes, you know. So like now you're part of the authority you've been given is to pull together the cleaning teams, and you wonder why they're moaning and resisting. And I did it last time, you know, like the kids with the dishes, you know. Well, I did them last night, you know, okay. But you wonder why the moaning starts and the change, because you are functioning in a position of authority, and that changes the relationship. And people don't understand, you know, when they've gone from this relationship with just mates to now you are in charge of this area and you're asking them to serve in this area, there's a shift that takes place. One of the problems with a lot of pastors and leaders is they don't understand that shift, and what they try to do is they try to maintain or to minister on a friendship basis all the time. It's just, you know, so what they try to do is they try to maintain friendship relationship and motivate people by their personality or by their charisma or by their friendship. And it's a real, quite a strong misunderstanding, because once you have been given by God, you know, a position of authority and leadership, then the relationship changes. You know, it actually changes. And you know, you're not trying to win them. You're not trying to win them anymore. You're trying to lead them to get the task done. To get, you know, you've got a job, you've got a task in the kingdom of God. You're advancing the kingdom. You've got to get that job done. And it's important that they understand and now submit to your leadership, so you can work together in unity and get the job done. And but when pastors and that, maybe through insecurity, try to, they think everybody, every, you know, the church is going to operate on all these friendships, it never works. And then when your friends get mad at you and leave, you know, it'll break your heart. You know, it always does break your heart whenever there's a divorce. And people don't understand that. People don't understand that about the church. If you come into the covenant relationship with the church and then you leave, you divorce. You're divorcing your spiritual family. That's what's actually going on. It's not just, you know, I go there because at the moment, you know, I like it, I like the music and everything like that, but something comes along, oh, I'll be down at the Baptist church down the road, or I'll shoot off over here, or I'll shoot off over there. Because that's a total misunderstanding of the body of Christ and the kind of relationship that God is trying to build within the body of Christ. You don't bail every time a problem. You work your problems through. Let the love of God increase. See, even like in Nancy and I relationship, you know, like every close, intimate relationship has its battles and its struggles. But I remember for years I said to Nancy, look, our battles and our struggles are ours. They are our, we own them. They're our, not in a negative way, but they're our. That's what makes us who we are. When we work through those battles and struggle, we come out the other side. That's part of our development. That's part of who we are. We own that, but it makes you stronger. It's because sometimes in a relationship, you'll get one person who's dominant and the other person who's dead. You know what I mean? And they, you know, we talk about, you know, they're a doormat. A man can be a doormat just as much as the wife can be a doormat. Don't worry about it. Some poor old men are just so henpecked by their wives and everything. You feel absolutely sorry for them. You know, they're running, whimpering around behind them like this. Or they walk funny. They have their arms stiff. They're like, what are those penguins? They get a penguin spirit. Yeah. Or the dominant husband who's wanting to control the wife. You know, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do that. Don't get too happy, you know. Well, of course, we're not going to get too happy because you're around. But anyway, But understanding, like a love relationship is meant to improve and release and develop us. It's meant to make us better. It's not without its battles, though. It's not without its struggles. And you'll never be in any family or any church without its battles, its misunderstanding and its struggles. But if every time something comes up, you throw your toys out of the cot, you know, you'll be like Israel in the desert. You'll be wandering around for 40 years until you learn the lesson. Anyway, that's really exciting stuff. And also, your understanding of a relationship as being a leader or under a leader. When you get a handle on that, and people hate this word, but the principle of submission to leadership, when you get a handle on submission to God, when you get a handle on that ultimately we are part of God's family and our submission this level is actually to Him. It's the same with when Don said, someone came up to him and said, oh, you're doing all this, the church is using you. No. If you're not doing it for the Lord, don't do it. The church doesn't owe you nothing. You say, oh, I've been in the working bee Tuesday, Thursday, months and months and months on end. What did I get out of it? Well, just what you got out of it is the revelation that you're not doing it for God. That's what you got out of it. You got a mean old heart. You're not really serving the Lord. You're just self-serving. And you were doing everything you were doing, you were expecting some sort of return. Well, you see, sometimes you've got to store up treasure in heaven. If I was looking for a return, the church couldn't afford to pay me what I'm worth for the hours that I put in. Absolutely true. That's the reality. But I'm not looking for that. See, that's. I mean, I need to pay my bills. You know, we've got to turn the heaters on in the wintertime and have a nice pot roast. Second day, Nancy did a nice pot roast. I'm not eating now. I whiz home at lunch and get stuck into that pot roast. She's not around. I'm eating my way through the whole thing. But that's not why I'm alive. That's not why I'm living. That's why, like, serving the Lord, storing up treasure in heaven. Get into the end of the day and you're absolutely exhausted, and you just feel the smile of God. You've been pushing to advance the kingdom of God, and God's just smiling down at you. That's it. That's the reward. You know, you don't need someone to come up and burst your bubble or blow your bubble. You know, say, "Oh, you're amazing." You know. You get to the point actually in your life where whether it's criticism or praise, it doesn't affect you. You know, whereas when you start out, you know, the praise lifts you up and the criticism puts you down, you know. So your whole life's like this. Well, remember that thing? I just thought of that really terrible, I'm a silly seagull flying in the sky, ever, flying so high, flying so low. What was that? You can never catch me, oh dear, no. Just a silly seagull, that's all. Fly away, Peter, fly away, Paul. I'm going back, aren't I? I'm in the, gone back into the Ancient of Days somewhere. That was like Spike Milligan or one of those things. But if your life is dependent on praise and the adoration of people, that's what your life is going to be like. It's just going to be, you're going to be so miserable. You know, you're going to be up and down, up and down, up and down, waiting for the next praise report about how wonderful you are. Oh, yes, that's me. You're talking about me again. I tell you, it's a hell of a way to live. You know, and it's often born out of insecurity in that. No, we're serving the Lord. He said to the Pharisees, you go out there praying on the street corners so everybody can see what you're doing praying around there. You know, but it's what you're doing in secret. It's the secret heart. I think the reward of the Lord, it's all those things. There's people, you know, and I'm not going to even name any names because I don't want you to get overexcited about yourselves tonight, but there's people in the church here that just do so many things that other people don't notice. So much work goes on behind the scene. They're not making a big fuss out of it. They just come in and, you know, they get the bucket and spade and they do what they need to do. They're just in there doing all sorts of things going on. We all receive the benefit of it. Not even aware of who's actually doing it. But I read a scripture, I haven't got it here tonight, but I read a scripture about the eyes of the Lord. He doesn't miss anything. And so all the things that all the leaders and everybody else in the church miss, he never misses for a moment. And it also says that his reward, he gives us the reward. He rewards us. He rewards us. You can't, I'll tell you, you can't outgive God. God's so incredible. So anyway, in this relationship, you know, it talks about where the lively stones were built together. And the stones, this where our friends in the body, our brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, they're all on that level and they support us. You know, if you're a block in the wall there and you've got two blocks beside you, that are you're just friends in the Lord. They support you. And then underneath, you know, there's blocks underneath, there's a foundation. It talks a lot about, because Jesus Christ is the cornerstone, and then it talks about the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. The apostles are not the kings at the top of the rung. They're the guys on the bottom. They're the foundational gifts. They're the ones that are holding the weight and the responsibility. They're the servants of all. That's the reality. When you see ministry and they've become the king of the ministry, you know, it's all hail the king. They're out of place. They don't realize they just need to get down out of their high place, right back down to where they belong. And it's foundational. But the functional side of being in the body is you'll have people underneath you, and a better sometimes those who are in authority. Now, when you talk about authority, they might be serving down here, but their authority is over you. And that responsibility, like if you're going to solve a problem, you often will never solve it there. You go up, you go in the authority. That's where the solutions are. You don't, if you spend all your time just talking to your mates and never going to a fivefold ministry, you'll spend most of your life never getting resolution to your problems. Not that people can't be of assistance, but what you've got to understand in the body is God has gifted and graced certain people to bring the body to maturity. They are there to help you break through, to help you grow up, to help you advance, to help you get ahead, to help you overcome. That's why they exist in the body. So you need to tap in and utilize those people. It's actually interesting. In Amos, anybody been reading Amos this week other than me? It's one of those books you don't read very often, but this was in it's Amos 3:1. Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth, therefore I will punish you for all of your iniquities. And then it goes, there's quite a famous verse, verse 3. It says, can two walk together unless they're agreed? It talks about the prophetic, will a lion roar when he has no prey, and it goes through some of the prophetic stuff. But the interesting thing here, and this is another area that people often don't understand fully, is against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt. All the way through the history, Old Testament history, when Israel had a good godly king, the whole nation was blessed. When they had an ungodly king, the whole nation went into captivity and into a curse. You as the head of your home, the mum and dad, the father and the mother in the home, and I believe that the father particularly has a special place in the home. If you get knocked out, you get out of sorts, you get resentment, you struggle, you get... What it actually does is it takes the covering or the protection off the family. And then what happens is the kids get attacked. Like the part of the thing, like if I was living in compromise and immorality, it would take the covering off the church. And then I just think mayhem would be taking place in the church. Because the anointing, God's authoritative anointings, whether it's in the church or in business or in your family, they are powerful because they actually provide a protection. It's like it talks about the covering in the Old Testament, like the fire by night and the cloud by day. It's that covering, it protects the body. So if the enemy can smash away at the father of the house, get them all confused and upset and mad, it like removes the covering off the family. And it opens up the family to another level of attack or opposition that they may not be ready for or aware of or suspecting. And so then, that's why every part of our relationship structure is so absolutely vital. Mum and dads have to work their issues out and stay united, because that puts the protection over the kids. The kids need to work their stuff out, especially their relationship with mum and dad, because it keeps that covering, it keeps the protection coming down over the whole body. In a local church, the other thing is too, is when division comes in the primary leadership of the church, that can shake things up in the church. And primary leadership, you need to be in one place, one heart, one spirit, one faith. The primary leadership of the church, you need to be totally committed to one another, because that you're holding, it's a God-given responsibility that we have. It's when God gives you the blessing of leadership, you also, with that comes a God-given responsibility to walk in the ways of God in that leadership. And if you can't resolve, if you get doctrinally whacked out into a different place or another way you get whacked out, or you're disagreeing with what's going on, you either need to resolve it or step down. Because those tensions they're not meant to be in the church. They can't survive, and it puts the body in jeopardy. It puts the body in jeopardy. So it might be, whether it's in the youth ministry, if the leadership team and the youth start getting division and people are pushing in different directions, it puts the youth ministry in jeopardy. And so maintaining those relationships and you know, like a teachable spirit, an open heart. I've been very concerned this year about the amount of deception getting around people's lives and the body. It's just, and a lot of it comes through the internet stuff and that. And the danger of what I'm finding trying to deal with these people is they've saturated themselves. By the time you hear about it, they've saturated themselves so much in the false teaching, it's almost impossible to get them back into spiritual reality. It's a really, really, really interesting dynamic that was going on. I want to tell you, doctrinal deception is actually a demon. If you understand this, because often what happens when people consolidate and their doctrinal positions, and it's contrary to the house that you're supposed to be a part of, what actually happens if you become unteachable, if you don't keep an open spirit that there may be stuff in the Bible that you don't see at this point and you don't understand. If you don't remain teachable, not only within the church, but within your relationship with God, if you think you've got it all sorted, you're already in deception. You're already beginning to lock down, you're locking down really your faith and the ability for the Holy Spirit to correct and direct and shift you into greater revelation of what God has. And you may say, oh, no, that won't happen. I think half of the body of Christ in the world is locked down like that. And you go to a reform theological church group that has cessation theology, they believe pastors, evangelists and teachers are allowed to operate in the world today, but God no longer are their prophets and apostles. But you try to talk to them about it, share with them, they've formulated their beliefs and their doctrine. They're not going to shift you. God's not going to shift them. In fact, the deception is they believe God has got them there. That's what happened. That's the next stage, is I believe God has shown me this. You go to the world, hey, wait a minute, in the Bible, don't you realize that after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, don't you realize it was after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ in the book of Ephesians that the revelation came that God gave apostles and prophets and teachers and pastors and evangelists? So the apostolic ministry didn't stop with the 12. Do you know another thing? I'll just read you this, because this is just an interesting thing about that. This is Acts chapter 1, verse 14. This is before the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're in the upper room. And this is interesting too. It says, Acts 1, 14, they all joined together constantly in prayer. And I love this, along with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. This is the upper room. They're all together. The women are there. They specifically mention the women are there, right? And they're all together in prayer. And so verse 20, it goes through Acts 1:20. They begin to talk about, because Judas had fallen, and so there's only 11 apostles, and they needed to replace an apostle. This is before the return. This is before the return. Jesus Christ comes back. This is after the resurrection. So they said, may another take his place, Judas's place of leadership. Therefore, it is necessary to choose from one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living amongst us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. So here we are. This is just before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the cloven tongues of fire and the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the miraculous revelation of the Holy Spirit coming into the church. Before that happened, they're in that same upper room, men and women. And because one of the other attacks on the body of Christ is the diminishing the place of women in the body of Christ. Jesus Christ came and liberated women. He doesn't want women to sit over there, the men to sit over there. You've all got to have hat doilies, I call them doilies, on your head and all of that. The thing about it is some of these churches around, it's so ridiculous what they do, because instead of having holiness of heart and life and love and intention, the holiness has all come on the external behaviour. So the woman, that guy I talked about a couple of times, when you go and read his constitution, and the woman are not allowed to have it wear a dress to church that is over 5 inches off the ground. Will you show me that in the Bible? You know, in their thing, it talks about there's pictures of open toe shoes. How did Jesus get to that church? He wore sandals. You're not allowed to wear sandals. I went and read their constitution. It's bizarre. We came out of a holiness movement. We came out of the Nazarene church. It wasn't to that extreme, but it was over the edge. It was over the edge. And the first time that we went to Kansas City, America, to the headquarters of the Nazarene church, the big headquarters, and they had this great big publishing house. It was huge. They just printed their materials and Bibles and all sorts of big, big publishing house. So they give you tours of the publishing house. You know, you go to the mecca of the denomination and you see the publishing house, and this is where the general superintendent's offices are, and this is all this and this and this. And we go in there and they do tours of the publishing. We went on a tour of the publishing house. Nancy's only in there for 2 minutes. She says, is this a cult? Because here's all the women, their clothes up to here, frilly little arm things down, their dresses all down here. Mate, it was like going back into the, one of those guys that, you know, they still have horses, the Amish. It's like going back in the Amish. But my struggle is, like, so the women are on that side, the men are on that side. I don't know if it's left and right, if there's a proper side. What if the woman all shifted and they all sat on the right-hand side instead of the left-hand side? Oh, my God, that'll all go to hell probably. I don't know what would happen. But so they got dresses down here, they got all of this going on. Men all have to have their hair cut. What about Jesus, who was a Nazarite, under the Nazarite vow, who was not allowed to cut his hair? See, people are dumb. There's a lot of dumb stuff goes on out there. It really is dumb. So anyway, so you've got this going on, and you've got all of these religions. It's all trying to be externally holy. And the heart can be as corrupt as all hell. But we're all dressing like this, and, you know, we're all wearing these, we're all sitting on the right side of the ledger and all of this sort of stuff. It's false. It's a false. Now, another thing is that is false is the attack on women in ministry. It's said in the book of Joel, and on the day of Pentecost, Peter gets up and he says, this is what was spoken about by the prophet Joel, and in these days I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men and young men, my handmaidens, I'll pour out my spirit and they'll prophesy. And so somehow or other now, you know, there is a church called the Exclusive Brethren, and what they're excluding is often woman's role within the body of Christ. You look at Nancy's been teaching me about Mary, not the one who was a prostitute, but the other Mary who followed Jesus. She was wealthy. She got set free from seven demons. These are my Bible studies I'm getting at the moment. She was going to preach on it, but I'm getting in before her. So, because she told me about it. Like, if you want to share the revelation, don't tell me, because I'm a sanguine. I'm going to tell everybody about it and pretend it's mine. You know what I mean? Nancy often says to me on the way to church, she says, what are you preaching on? I'm not telling you. There's things that you are to know not. People don't understand, because if you let the revelation out before the time, it often doesn't carry the weight. So there's nothing worse than on your way to church or you've been asking 412 to give your testimony and your friends are all pumping you for what are you going to say, what are you going to say. You say it all there. Then when you get up to say it there, it's lost half its power for some reason. I don't know why. I can't give you a verse for it. Anyway, there's just a huge attack in woman and ministry, the place of woman and ministry. So there she was. She had seven demons cast out. She was a woman of wealth. She travelled everywhere Jesus Christ and supported him out of her wealth, and wasn't she the first one, Nancy left to correct me, to see after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and the angel came, who'd he come to? He came to Mary. She was the first one to get the message. And then we say, woman can't preach. And what did she do? He said, go in and tell the rest of those yobbos, I've risen. He didn't say, don't say a word until one of the guys come along. Don't you know your place in the body? Peter, Paul, where are you? So they build doctrines and that around taking out half of God's workforce, dismantling their anointing, dismantling their place and their function of body. You read the book about Yongi Cho, if it wasn't for the women in Yongi Cho, like 90% of all the cell group leaders were women. That church that grew to 1 million people, basically in their culture, it was even culturally against the role of woman to do what they were doing. But when the Holy Spirit got a hold of them, they just went out and God used them to build at that time the largest church in the face of the earth. So some of the, we've got to get a better understanding on some of the, you know, women are not to speak in church. They speak everywhere, mate. Where are they meant to prophesy then? It's like, it's some of it, people misunderstand that you don't get deep enough in the scripture to get an understanding. So you make a quick judgment about the legalistic side of the scripture and then you count them all out, they're not allowed to speak. The covering is, the reason that I love women in ministry is actually some of the most powerful ministry in our conferences is often the woman when they speak. That's the reality of it. And the covering they're talking about is not Nancy sitting there with a doily on her head. It's actually the relationship that Nancy and I have and the submission that she has in the house. Not because I'm lording it over her, but because she understands the principle. Like the centurion, it's the same principle as centurion. Jesus said, I haven't seen such face in all of Israel. What did the centurion, who wasn't even a Jew, what did he do? He said, you don't have to come to heal my servant. I'm a man of authority like you. Just say the word and he'll be healed. And then Jesus, he wipes out all of the Jews, basically. Not killing them or anything like that, but he basically says, I have not seen such great faith in the whole of Israel. There's not one of you that's operating in the faith of this guy. That's kind of what he's saying. Often he said to the Jews, you remember he said to the Jews, oh, ye of little faith. Is challenging their faith. So, but what the centurion had was an understanding of submission to authority. It's not being lorded over. It's not being controlled. It's not being manipulated. I'm going to finish with this, and that's another miracle that's going to take place tonight, is me finishing. But I want you to see something here, and I wrote it down somewhere, and I want you to see how they start their writings in the Word of God. What's the time? I got 1 minute. All right, here we go. I just want to throw this out to you. Romans 1:1, start. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. James 1:1, James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad.
So he was called to the to Israel, the tribes of Israel. 2 Peter 1:1, Simon Peter, a bond servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. Jude 1:1, Jude, a bond servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ. Revelation 1:1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, John, his servants, the things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. And what you're going to understand about the bond servant, and this is something that we should really aspire to. What you've got to understand about the bond servant is often people were enslaved because they owed debt. And so they couldn't pay their debt, so they'd go to work for the person they owed the debt to. And they would be enslaved or in bondage to them until the debt was actually worked off. Often at the end of the time when the debt was worked off, the person who was enslaved would go to the owner, would go to the master, I suppose you might want to call that, and say, I want to remain in your household. And they became a bond servant. And in other words, they were a servant by choice. They were no longer obligated to be there. They were free. They could do whatever they wanted to do, but they came and said, they would say, I want to enslave myself to you, to your household and to your people. They would take an awl. I know what an awl is because in Carpet Lane, we used to have an awl. An awl is like a screwdriver, but it just has a sharp point. And when you're measuring with your tape, like the old days, you'd put your tape down there in the little silver ring, you'd push your awl in and you waddle along with your tape. Otherwise, if you didn't have the awl in there, every time you pulled the tape, it would come away from the wall and you're running backs and forwards. And so what they would actually do, the bondservant, they'd take an awl and they would pierce the air with the awl, and that represented that they had chosen, and you won't like the word slave, but they had chosen to enslave themselves to that family from that day on. They became a part of the family. It was their absolute choice. Just about every one of the apostles, when they're opening and saying who they are and declaring that, they're all saying, I'm a bond servant of Jesus Christ. That's the evidence. I'm in submission to the Lord Jesus. My life has been absolutely, totally given over to him from this day forward. I tell you what, it's the most beautiful position that you can ever find in the Christian faith. It's like, it's just like that. No longer struggling or fighting. It's just, I'm yours. Whatever you want me to do, I'm yours from this day forward. It's a place of peace. It's just such a, it's hard to explain. I know a lot of you are nodding because you already understand what I'm trying to say, but it's just this wonderful place of submission to God. Who was the most submissive person on the face of the earth? Jesus Christ. Who was the most powerful? Jesus Christ. Who did the best miracles? Jesus Christ. Why did all that happen? Because he submitted himself completely to the Father and did nothing except what the Father told him to do. See, that's the gospel. So, Father, I just thank you for tonight. I thank you, Lord, for this incredible body of believers, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you are bringing revelation. You're knitting our hearts together in love. You're confronting deception and all kinds of things. You're helping us to understand the power of loving relationships. And Father, I just want to speak a blessing over each and every one that's here tonight. I speak a blessing, Lord, over everyone who tunes in online. I know there's often hundreds that tune in online and the Watch the Ministry. And I just declare a blessing over you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And I just want to declare, let the love of God be shed abroad in all of your hearts by the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, greet one another with a holy hug, a handshake and a blessing, and then clear off and go and have a good sleep.